from today. As you all know, the lecture is going to be on speed and hazard management with respect to safety. So myself, Dr. Ramapalli Madhu, senior principal scientist. So let us see how this topic can be dealt in this presentation. So we all know, we have, means many times you might have seen such kind of boards. For example, weed kills, bud kills, and some poetries. So something like some funny poetry also, which may not be taken very seriously by the road users. Now the situation has arrived, so we have to convey the message very seriously. For example, like we have to show this is the thing, it kills like that. So with that, let us go into the presentation. So this presentation has two parts. First one is speed related aspects, and we will understand safe system, need for speed management, and also effect of speed on accidents, and we will see speed control measures as well. So second part is going to be hazard related issues we will be, and how, what are those hazards and how we have to manage. We will touch some issues about crash barrier treatment also. So firstly, to see what is a safe system. So if you see the slide, it is actually an infrastructure. You have to aim for an infrastructure that reduces the risk of death and the serious injury. So that is what safe system deals with. And main point is here, safe system philosophy, it should recognize that people will continue to make mistakes and crashes will continue to occur. So the system has to understand there is a human element involved and how to deal with this human element. So the system should not take for granted that everybody would be ideal, and then everybody would be perfect, and then there will not be any mistake from road users. So the system actually have the provision, if at all any mistake happens by the road user, so how we can deal with that mistake. So the safe system seeks not to penalize road users with death or serious injury when they make mistakes. So this is what mainly in the safe system consider. That means if anybody does some small mistake, because we are all humans, we will make mistakes. Humans are bound to make mistakes and they tend to make mistakes. How those mistakes can be taken by the system and forgive that system and then turn it into a safe situation. Not like turning into a very grievous situation. So this is what the main aspects in the safe system consider. So here, some components we can see in the safe system. Basically, for example, there are many components which go simultaneously. Mainly, if you can see here, there are three components: safer speeds, safer vehicles, safer roads. They will be consistent with each other and working together, and there are also other parameters working from outside to these parameters, like admittance to system, understanding crashes and roads, and education and enforcement also. All these systems has to work simultaneously, and then we will be finally achieving the safe travel. That's what the safe system aims. So here, out of these, safer speeds are going to play a very important role, and these safer speeds can be achieved through speed management that we will see in the later slides. So why speed management is important? Because safe and efficient travel is the cornerstone, we all know, for a healthy and prosperous society. And to balance between appropriate travel speeds and road trauma, so speeds have to be maximized and trauma has to be minimized. So the balance has to be maintained. In order to implement the safest system, we cannot bring the speeds into slow speeds. So there should be a balance between these two. So speeds has to be maximized, and at the same time trauma also to be minimized. So speed management, again, it's a mix of these three parameters, what you can see here: infrastructure, education, and enforcement. So these three things have to be appropriately considered. One of the tool is like speed limits. Using speed limits, we can manage the speeds. That's what in our hand we can in the speed management. As you can see from this slide here, speed and intensity of the crash. If the speed of these vehicles would have been less, then obviously the intensity of the crash would have been less.
Yes.
So this is what we are aiming, how we can bring down this intensity of the crashes. So that is dependent on the speed. So how we can effectively reduce the speeds, as we have seen in the previous slides, how we can optimize the speeds, and then accordingly how we can reduce such kind of high intensity crashes. So the speed and crashes are directly, you can see that they are always related with the intensity of the crash. If these vehicles travel in lower speeds or safer speed, then the severity would have been much more less. Even some examples, this may be the old example, but here you can see the very high safe cars, what we call like very good company of cars. So if they also involve in high speed crashes, then also the damage is going to be so severe. So it is to just to say that how the speeds are going to affect the high safe cars and high-end cars, same fate will be there. So we have some supporting data also. We can see that speeding is the main causes. If you go into accident records, whatever we have with us, published by the ministry and all, so they mention that almost 50% of the accidents are related to overspeeding, whatever it may be, but the data tells that speeding is the main reason. So there are some published reports, like here also we can see that speeding is the biggest problem. So latest data also, whatever we have published by ministry, there also we can see that speeding is the biggest cause of these road crashes. So coupled with the speed, and if there is an improper road design, then the accident would be severe one again. Here we can see that the road design is so poor that the vehicle actually in the curve gone away and fallen other side of the road. So if there is a proper super elevation or other design considerations, then this accident would have been controlled. Here we can say that it is a overspeeding type of accident. It is coupled with other issues as well. Let us see how the speed and other parameters like stopping distance and crash impact speed, how they are related with this schematic graph. When you see this graph, what we can understand that if at all any vehicle going at 50 kilometers per hour speed, so when they spot some object which is located at 45 meters, then the reaction time and the braking, so the vehicle would be able to stop at 35 meters. So that means there is a cushion of around 10 meters if at all vehicle going at 50 kilometers per hour. Then if the speed is at 55, increase of 5 kilometer speed, then it may reach up to 40 meters. So another 5 meters before the object. 60 kilometers per hour, then it will touch the object. 65, then it is going to hit the object, but at the speed of 32 kilometers per hour. That is called what we are seeing, crash impact speed, at speed at the time of impact. So, like that, this is an example, actually calculated. So, 70 kilometers, if the vehicle is traveling, then it is going to hit. That means the crash impact speed is going to be 46 kilometers per hour. And then 75, 57, 80 and 66. You can see that here, with the only 5 kilometers per hour increase in the speed, traveling speed, how the impact speed, crash impact speed increasing like this, exponentially. This is what just we want to understand. So, if we can control this operating speed little bit less, then the impact speed is going to be significantly reduced. That's what the main point what we can understand here. So, many people don't understand that what will happen even when I travel only less than 5 kilometers. If the speed limit kept at 60 kilometers per hour, if I travel at 65, there is not going to be much difference or something like that. But if at all any the vehicle involves in the crash, then the impact speed at that time of crash is going to be severe.
So in wet condition?
Much more. So the braking, it will be slipped and the impact speed is going to be slightly less.
Any relationship
with
But obviously the situation is going to be much more critical. It means impact speeds and other things are also would be higher. This is this slide is basically about the tolerance level. So if you see what is the tolerance level between the objects when they are involved in the crash. So that means beyond this speed, the chances of surviving in that crash would rapidly reduce. So that's what the tolerance level. The first is suppose car and pedestrian. If car is there, pedestrian as an object, so if they are involved in the crash, then the tolerance speed is going to be 20 to 30 kilometers per hour. Beyond this, the survival rate is going to be decreased. So this is what the tolerance level. And the car, motorcycle, if at all is there, again the same is the tolerance level. Car and pole are any tree, 30 to 40, and car to car and 50 if your side impact in the head-on collision. So like that, the tolerance level is different for different combinations. So mainly we can see that with respect to pedestrians or vulnerable road users, the tolerance level is less.
Sir, yes, it's back to that.
Yes.
Can you just explain that the last one, the car to car head on, the 70
km? Yeah, basically, if at all, this is 70 kilometers per hour is the head on collision. It's not that both the vehicles is traveling at 70 kilometers per hour. If they are traveling at 35 also, the impact speed is going to be 70. So when it is a head on collision, the speed will be cumulative. We have to add the speed, impact speed. So when they are hitting at the at each other head on collision, the impact speed is going to be sum of the both the speeds. So even vehicles traveling at 35 also, it will generate the impact speed of 70 kilometers per hour. So here, we will see this graph might have told by other faculty also, how the pedestrian crashed severely by the speed. You can see clearly that how the impact speed, this is impact speed, and how the probability of death is going to vary with this. So, as we can clearly observe this graph, you can see that from 40 to, you can say that 50 kilometers per hour, only 10 kilometers increase in the impact speed. as we have already discussed, normal operating speed and crash impact speed, there is a difference there. So if the impact speed is only increased by 10 kilometers per hour, the chances of actually, that means probability of death is going to be increased very significantly from 20% to even 80%, 60% increase with only 10 kilometers per hour crash impact speed. Crash impact speed 10 kilometers per hour means actual operating speed is going to be much more less. So we have to concentrate how to bring down this small amount of speed so that pedestrians will be stable. Suppose if the impact speed, if we can bring by reducing this 10 kilometers per hour only, minimum value, then we can increase the safety situation for the pedestrians significantly. So this is what many people may not be understanding, why we keep 30 kilometers per hour in the urban area, so that there will be a safe situation for pedestrians. If at all they hit, then the chances of survival for the pedestrian is going to be there. So marginal increase in that operating speed is going to change the situation completely. So this is what we need to understand and then see how we can achieve this safer speeds. So this is just some data. In CRRI has conducted so many surveys, how the speeds are there on our national highways or expressways. You can see how high they are with respect to many different vehicles. It could be going 150 or something like that. These days, we have very good roads and wide roads, so people tend to travel at very high speeds. And even you can see that this is another section, so we observed like 170 or something like that. People try to travel on that particular section. So, how achieving this in travel speeds, safer travel speeds, this is what we are seeing. So, we already discussed like speed limits are a management tool. So, it can be utilized so that we can bring down the speeds little bit and then we can achieve the safer conditions. So, here we can see how this safer travel speeds can be achieved. We can see that four components. One is like the infrastructure. In the infrastructure, we can install speed limits that map the roads and roadsides based on road features and crash rate. So, if you install speed limits, this is the infrastructure based treatment, we can achieve the safer travel speeds. Another one is like vehicle technology. So these days vehicles are coming with so many new technologies, like if you are traveling at very high speeds, the vehicle itself will be giving some alarms and beeps and something like that. And even when these days we use navigation systems, even that, those systems also give warning like prevailing speed and the running speed, then it will compare and then give some kind of warnings. So this is vehicle technology using like intelligent speed assistance. Education, like educating drivers about the speeding crash risk, like what we now just learned, how these speeds actually impacting the pedestrian so much, the marginal increase in the speed. Many people, as I told, many people think that I will slightly travel higher, not much more, like 5 kilometers per hour or 10 kilometers per hour than the speed limits, then understanding is not there in the many drivers. So education is going to play a role here, so that what is the basically the impact of the speed on the pedestrians and other non-vulnerable road users. Enforcement obviously is the main component. So based on the enforcement, the situation can be bring down in a safer conditions, like compliance with the speed limits, use of technology. These days In Delhi, everywhere cameras are there. So speed limit, when you cross, then immediately the challan will be coming to your home itself. So it may be there in many parts of the country. So this is another type of enforcement aspect. So based on this, people try to change their behavior in overspeeding. So in physically also, that is using some technology. Physically also, some places enforcement can be implemented in some risky hours or something like that. So speed limits we are seeing because speed is going to impact the human body like anything, because it is a force, so it will affect. And then lower speed limits with appropriate road design and enforcement will lead to lower speeds and therefore reduce road problem. So these are all has to be worked together, as I mentioned, like speed limits from the infrastructure point of view, and then road design also, and then enforcement, education, everything. So it will bring down the speeds and then reduce the road trauma. And then what the main thing what we are seeing, marginal reduction in the speed limit that can result in quantum drop in the casualty crash. So this is what we can take away from here, that if you can reduce the marginal speed marginally also, we can going to do the significant impact. So for that, appropriate speed limits has to be kept, and it will play important role and it becomes an integral part of safe system. So there are many studies, we are not going into that, how the speed limits are actually related with the operating speeds. So studies have been carried out, how the behavior is going to change in fact when we install the speed limit signs. So there is a significant relation between the speed limits and the prevailing speeds on the road. So this graph also you might have seen it from different faculty, mainly how the speed is impacting the severity of the accidents. And mainly here we can see that the percent change in speed is going to influence more on the fatal accidents. So this has to be kept in our mind so that we can control this fatality rate by changing speeds appropriately. So this is also same in quantities. For example, how the fatal accidents are going to reduce by reducing 10% of speed, or if you increase the, if the speed increases by 10%, how the fatality situation is going to change. And this is also again the relation between speed limit and then operating conditions. Here also we can see some relation. If you increase the speed limit, how the operating speed also increases. And if you decrease the speed limit, how the operating speed also decreases. This graph, again, rural condition and urban condition, how the speed limit, speed reduction actually influences the reduction in casualty crashes. So in rural condition, as you can see that there is a significant reduction compared to urban conditions. And here, road infrastructure, how the road infrastructure is going to affect the driver speeds. These are the parameters which are actually, you can see that how these infrastructure design elements are actually impacting the speeds. Like design speed is the one, if you lower the design speed, then we can expect the slowing conditions. If you are having higher design speed, then it will be higher speeds, accelerating. And then median, presence of median. Presence of median, if it is absent, then it will be lower condition compared to if it is a divided road. As we can all see that now it, undivided roads and divided roads, obviously speeds are higher on divided roads. Presence of median actually increases the speed. Then median width also, if the narrower is the median width, then the speeds are going to be less, and if it is wider, then the speeds will be higher. Turn lanes, similar like that, and road width, if it is narrower, then slower speeds, if it is wider, then it will be higher. Shoulder width, the number of lanes, lane width, all these infrastructure related parameters, how they actually influence the road prevailing speeds. So now how these speed limits, which is a management tool to achieve the road safety. So these speed limits has how we have to adapt. Otherwise, even using speed limits also, we can create a chaotic situation. We have to consider these things. It has to be consistently applied. For example, many times what happens by the road warning agencies, they may install from this place to this place 20 kilometers, then again there is no consistency, immediately maybe 60, again 30. So the situation should not be like that. That's why I feel that speed limit sign is the most disrespecting sign, like because of this situation, because consistency is not there. They don't understand from where to where the speed limit is there, from after that whether any restriction on the speed, all these things without any ambiguity. So it has to be told to the road. So consistency, clear and unambiguous, has to be there. The section has to be maintained from here to here. Sometimes even here also, police try to challan without having a speed limit sign also. So that also has to be kept in mind. We have to inform the road user that this is the area where the speed limit is applied. So we have to reduce the speed limit. So third one is in harmony with the desired road condition. So whatever we are actually looking for, so we have to have consistency also with that condition. Sometimes supported with engineering treatment is very much essential. Simply putting the speed limit will not help. Some engineering treatment is also required. Integral with police speed enforcement program. Sometimes this may differ. Police may come with the different speed limits, and road warning agents like PWD or other any agency, they will come up with the different speed limits. And both the speed limits will be there on the field. So it will create confusion. It has to be actually consistent with each other. So credible and compatible with the road user expectations. So road user expects some speed conditions. So we have to fulfill that desire also. For example, this is the Mumbai Pune Expressway some section. There, since it is an expressway, we don't have to completely ignore the condition and then give a high normal speed also. Some critical locations require some strict speed control programs. So such kind of location is very critical. So here the lesser speed is warranted. So we have to implement such kind of program, speed control programs at these locations. For example, these areas like horizontal alignment is there, vertical alignment is there. So there the speed limits are desirable. We have to keep. We have to advise the road users the speed has to be reduced. How this can be done? We have speed control devices like traffic signs are there. Using traffic signs is the only medium we can talk with the road users. So we have to have a good communication system, like traffic signs has to be standard. Traffic signs need to be used. We have like IRC 67 is there, so as per that we have to implement. So this is the speed limit sign, how So it looks like, so there are different speed limit signs. For example, first one is regular speed limit sign, it's a fixed one. And secondly, variable speed limit signs, what we can see here. Speed may change according to the situation. This is a display kind of thing. So it depends upon the situation, the speed, the number will be changing. And then area speed limit, so entire area can be kept as a speed limit zone or something. Repeater signs are advisable if at all the length of the section is very long. So repeater signs, so that user may be continuously warned that this is the speed limit section. Advanced warning, it's kind of warning sign. In terms of warning also we can give advisory speed limit, sometimes we can give advisory speed limits also. Transitional speed limits, this is basically like we want to achieve 40 kilometers per hour, but the section is actually 80 kilometers per hour. In that case, or 100 kilometers per hour, first instead of from 100 to 40 immediately giving like that, it can be given first 80 for some sections from advance to this location, and after that for some sections 60 kilometers per hour, something like that. When we give in this fashion, this is called the transitional speed limits. And using another control device is road markings. We can also utilize these road markings to implement the speed limits, and some physical road alterations also is possible. For example, we can narrowing the streets, removing the pavement surface for lower speeds, chokers or median islands we can create, and then we can reduce the speeds. Pavement markings, anyway we have seen that, and speed bumps or humps and tables. So these are the things we can introduce in the urban areas. I find out if we are talking. And then, yes.
So can we put the circle in there?
Here.
No parking similar to.
No, it's not in red. White only. So road markings, it is having a standard IRC 35. So as per IRC 35, we can implement these road markings designs.
So is there any study between the speed and the probability of an accident?
Yeah, not here, but in other countries it has been done. So that's what we have seen with respect to pedestrians, and also with respect to normal motor vehicles also we have seen how the speed actually influencing the severity of the accident. So when the speed increases, the rate, how the rate is changing. So we have seen that cattle accidents are injurious accidents and normal accidents, it will vary, the rate will vary based on the speed. So that type of, we have seen that graph also. So unfortunately, we have not done that kind of study in India, but other countries these kind of literature is available, and the same trend, we believe that same trend is applicable for our Indian country.
The other question is, suppose you have a 6-lane divided highway. Okay, a pedestrian walks at 1.2 meters per second. So for clearing the 3 lanes, he needs 9 seconds. Okay, and if the design speed is 80 on the 3 lanes, then in 9 seconds, 180 meters is the distance that is going to be traveled by the vehicle there. So then if you are having a pedestrian crossing there, that means that gap has to be 180.
Correct.
But nowhere it will be 180.
Yeah, that is the issue.
But then why are the engineers, why don't we say yeah. that this is wrong?
Yeah, correct. Your mind is very, very good point. So whenever the pedestrian crossing is there, we have to ensure the speed actually around that point, around that section. So the width of the road increases, then accordingly the speed has to be controlled. And then before pedestrian, the speeds have to be bring down to that speed actually, so that the pedestrian finds gap and he will be able to cross the entire section. So this is what actually we have.
Traffic
need not to stop. In highways, we don't make the traffic to stop. But accordingly, speeds can be managed.
But NHA doesn't agree. He says 80 means 80. So you will not change the.
So if at all that 80 has to be there, at grade pedestrian crossing should not be there.
80 kilometers.
80 kilometers under pedestrian underpass has to be there. Pedestrian underpass has to be there. If at all 80 kilometers per hour, and all NH basically they give this kind of PUPs, pedestrian underpass. Otherwise, if at all you want to give at grade pedestrian crossing, normally we don't give on NHS, but if at all we have to do, so we have to ensure this. This is what the engineers has to do, and also road safety auditors has to point out. NHA will build like that only, or any road agency will build like that only. But the road safety auditors, when we go for the audit, this has to be pointed out, and we have to ensure that it has to be corrected.
No, but if it is gradually reduction at the point of where the pedestrian crossing is there, suppose you reduce it, accordingly the distance also will reduce. I mean, they will not take 80 kilometers per hour speed and design for 180 meter as you said it.
At grade crossing is there. Then speeds have to be reduced and speed limit has to be given, or if at all even if the speed limit is not working, we have to go with the some kind of physical alteration as well. That's why people give raised bars and transverse raised bars, all those things has to be given.
So from UT National Highway 65, from Kodar till Zahirabad, more than 200 kilometers. Pedestrians are crossing everywhere, but we don't have a VUP anywhere. Then you see National Highway 44, it will be more than 350 kilometers from Karnool till Hyderabad.
Yes.
There is no vehicle underpass or foot overbridge or nothing.
But
pedestrians are crossing.
No, see.
It is cutting across villages also.
So this is what now. So basically, when they design such kind of facility, all the crossing facilities has to be ensured. Why these people, what they do in order to cut their project cost? So they take out all the safety features. This is what happening and happened all these days. So that's why the situation is not changing at all in our India. So we have to, as safety auditors, when we do the safety audit, we have to mention this thing very critically and ensure that this has to be implemented. Otherwise, road warning agency, they will try to cut the cost and then implement, and then it will run like that. So this has to be changed. So that's what we are actually trying, and we have to... Giving training and lectures to state level engineers also, so that they will get some flavor of road safety. So like that, it is an ongoing process. We have to continuously do it, and then the change can be expected after this. So you are very right. There are so many sections, not only NH44 and even in Andhra. Many places we have gone through, and many places this kind of situation is there, and then we try to give our recommendation. It has to be like that, and then finally somehow it may go to their authorities and they will again cut it, and then we have to continuously ensure that they should implement. So one has to look into this. So this is our combined duty. So we have to ensure the road safety on such kind of situation. So that is what the speed related management, what we are seeing, how we can enhance the road safety. The second part is hazard management.
Sir, like you have DPM, sir, thermoplastic market, or you have the rubber strip, sir. Can you share with us how many sets of 4 rubber strips if you want to reduce the 3 by 10, by 20 or by 30, sir?
Yeah, it is there with us. It is there. So how much thickness is required to reduce the speed?
How many sets of 4
sets also. Normally 6 sets or 4 sets. Dr. Velmogan, maybe how many dBm's? With respect to speed reduction, exactly.
It is between 3 to 6, sir. It is, but it depends on the distance. Initially you will have longer distance, as we approach to the hazard, it will be shorter in distance. So the sets, each set will have 6, sir. So it will, go up to a maximum 3 to 6.
So how much speed reduction?
Speed reduction we expect is it's a soft traffic calming measure. First and foremost we have to understand. So it is not more than 25 to 30%. It is not going to be a huge effect. That's why you are intention to put it on even on the highway also.
So it is not a stopping condition. So it is a consideration, but the speed will be reduced.
Which I have to quote, sir?
35 also. And also IRC 99. IRC 35 details pura diya. 35 is more detailed. Okay. So going to the second one, which is also very important, roadside hazards. So let us understand this also in detail. So now we are seeing on the road how the speed has to be maintained, how the safety, safer travel has to be maintained. So now we will see outside of the road. So how they are going to influence the safety situation. So roadside hazard, that means whatever the objects which are not on the road, adjacent to the road, close to the road. So what will happen if at all those things will be there? There is a possibility that the vehicles may go away from the road and speed. So now we want to consider such kind of situations also. Such kind of drivers also. If at all driver lose control and go away from the road. So how to ensure, how to maintain the safety even for that type of road drive user. For that errant road user. So how the safety can be ensured, we will see. So normally with the roadside hazard, what we can get, hit object type crashes, because they are going to object, the vehicle is going to hit that objects. And this is basically why vehicles normally leave the road. So why we should bother? We all know vehicles may leave the road for a variety of reasons, as we have seen. In case of driver, there can be fatigue, inattention, distraction. Because of that, the vehicle may go away from the road. Vehicle, there may be mechanical failure, basically tire or steering failure or unstable load. So because of that also, vehicle will go away from the road. And then traffic condition, suppose suddenly animal coming on the road, and then because of that, vehicle may have to go away from the road, even animals or pedestrian or any other vehicles. Road and environment, because of the environment, weather conditions or geometry change. So there may be so many reasons, combinations of these reasons. So vehicle may go away from the road. So for that situations, how we have to do the measures so that the safety can be maintained. So other types types of road side hazards, like natural features, it may be natural thing coming, or some public utilities, or any traffic infrastructure, drainage structure, or any some streetscape elements or street furniture. So there can be so many elements which may be there on the roadside. So how we have to deal with such kind of roadsides. So the basic concept is the roadside has to be a forgiving roadside. So if at all a vehicle goes, the roadside has to forgive, and then it should not actually affect that vehicle severely. So in that case, we should have the recovery area, sufficient recovery area, that is a traversable area on the roadside, which allows a driver to regain control. If at all he go away from the road, he if you provide that some recoverable area, so it, the vehicle may come back from that area. If there is no space at all, then it will not come, then it will directly go and hit the objects. So that's what clear zone, this clear zone concept has to be there. That is roadside border area beginning at the edge of the traveled way and clear of all hazards and obstructions. So this is, we will see more details on clear zone later, soon in part of the presentation. Cross section, so design elements and not hazardous to errant vehicles. So all those things has to be ensured. So this is the just description how the clear zone should look like for high speed corridors especially. And there are some design aspects with respect to design speed, how much should we have the clear zone, length of the clear zone, that means from the edge of the travel way. So when the design speed increases, then obviously the clear zone also, width of the clear zone also will increase. Another photograph having his clear zone. So those photographs may be from other countries, but this is from our country only. The clear zone concepts are very well implemented in our situation as well. We can see the different sections. So this clear zone width, in case of embankment, how it has to be there. For example, you can see the graph here. For 95 kilometers, we need to have 7.5 meter clear zone. So like that, we need to have, and the clear zone is varying from 3 to 7.5 for less than 95 kilometers.
For so normally have 2.5 only 1 meter paved shoulder, 1.5 meter paved shoulder.
Correct.
That's all,
anywhere
you go, that's all.
But when you want to implement the high speed corridors.
But we have high speed corridors, but
it is there in the standards. Now we have to ensure, that's what the duty of the auditor has to be told, that clear zone has to be there. So there are some sections.
That is the reason the safety barrier they proposed.
That's what, now we will come into that.
All the lectures. That yes. Is where, you know, leading to, it's a design problem. Well, see, these things has to be designed by the expert engineers, whoever is doing all these things, the consultant. And in this, you have foreigners involved in this. Okay. Now, all these codes are available, and things are getting sanctioned. So, but when these things are not adhered to the code or provisions, what is happening?
Yeah, that's what this is. The situation is not good.
And sanctioned and executed. And the code or provisions are
the so that is the way. If everything is followed as per the code, and there is no need to do the auditing or anything, because everything will be ideal situation, we are going ideal world. So, nothing is required, since it is not happening.
These things were normally at least followed in
state roads.
Yes. These will not get sanctioned.
But you will not believe, if you go to the state department and then try to tell them the safety, they will not be able to understand at all, because safety is very last for them.
No, but
that is what we have to
follow this code of provisions, it is automatically.
That's what. They don't know the code also.
Not 100%.
Suppose engineers.
100% of the safety aspect is achieved by following the code of
provisions. Correct.
Let us leave that discussion out.
So that is the implementation thing.
See, you as an auditor, you have to point it out. And if somebody doesn't do it, then you will record it in your statement. That is the basic. No, you can't really discuss that, which is the institution and the organization which can follow it. You expect better things will happen. Otherwise, if they don't follow it, like a trash scenario is going to remain the same.
So that is the situation now. We need to.
We allow you to finish it up, then you kindly ask
questions. Sir, is there any code that dictates that these barriers, if these are shock absorption barriers, is there any code that dictates there is any collision? So So how much shock absorption will be there? What kind of barrier can be put when we cannot have the load?
There is a code 119 is there. There are different crash barriers are given. So now another new type of crash barrier is also coming, like roller based crash barrier. So there we can see where to install the part. So we can get the information. Figure is there. I will tell you where the clear zone comes. So this is the length of the clear zone. Even in cut zone also, cut section, the clear zone concept has to be there. If at all, it is a high speed car. So like this, this is travel way, and then clear zone has to be implemented like this. So as you are asking the question, the clear zone is basically starting from from the traveled way. This is a carriageway, it includes shoulder also, and then there is a recoverable slope and all those things. So this is the IRC code, which tells about 9 to 11 for speed of 100 to 120 kilometers. If you are designing this, for this, so 9 to 11 meter has to be there, starting from the travel. Okay, that includes shoulder cell. So this is for 90 meter right of way, how the cross section should look like for high speed corridors, including the clear zone aspects. Okay, so this is what IRC SP 99, we can find the width of the clear zone and the concept. It's a carriageway, and then how the clear zone and this 11 meter should come. So like this,
start from the paved shoulder.
Carriageway, that includes the shoulder also. Paved shoulder also comes under the clear zone. Yeah. So like this, we have defined in our codes also. So we can clearly see. So this barrier are coming into the picture. When it will come? When there is no option of providing clear zone. So then we have to go for the barriers. So the barrier, actually here we can see barrier required for the hill section height is more than 3 meter and the slope is more than 1:3. If these conditions are not followed, means unable to follow, then we have to go for the barrier there. Some different types of crash barriers, somebody was asking. So majorly three types, rigid barrier or semi-rigid, you can say metal beam, and then flexible also, wire roped kind of things are also there. We can implement according to the situation. So again, two types of crash barrier, like safety barrier, like roadside safety barrier, median side safety barrier also we can implement. And then roadside safety barrier, based on the height of embankment, okay, and radius of the curve. In the curves, based on the radius also, this has to be implemented. And roadside obstacles, if obstacles are there, so then there is no possibility of being clear zone there, then crash barrier has to be there. And then median side safety barrier. So median side also, based on the type and width of the median. Median width is also not that much is available. So median crash barrier has to be given. Usually on great flyovers or some bridges, if at all median is there. And radius of horizontal curvature. Even at the curves also, in the central median, one has to give the crash barrier. Some examples, some photographs, but where we can see crash barriers in different situations, the shoulder side and the medial side. And some other photograph, we can see crash barriers. But when we do the crash barriers, again, we have to keep in our mind, so these crash barriers should not be acting as roadside hazard itself. So poor design and installation can make this safety barrier also becomes roadside hazard. That's what we have to take utmost care. We want to avoid this hazard, and then this barrier is installed, and then this barrier should not act as a hazard itself. So we have to follow the proper implementation. So we have to see whether this barrier is going to be more severe than the object protecting. If you don't install this barrier, then the severity is going to be less. Then it is a very bad implementation. So anti treatment is essential for this. Most of the places they don't concentrate on the ends, so anti treatments are has to be done. So there are some problems just highlighting. Some gaps between the barriers, these and all is not warranted. It again increases the occurrence of crashes. This is what anti treatment. It is a very dangerous situation. The barrier is going to act as a hazard, and then it will increase the road crash severity like anything. Otherwise, if the barrier is not there, the severity would have been lesser. So, anti treatment has to be given as given in the model provisions. So, like this, the anti treatment was. Another one is these days roller based crash barriers are coming. Even the code is not there, but they are there. It is coming, and the impact is absorbed by the crash barrier more effectively compared to other crash barriers. So it has been implemented in south like east coast road Chennai. So it is, as per the reports, it is working efficiently. So the barriers where we should implement
the guide also.
Yes.
These things they guide the vehicle also.
Correct. That is the advantage. So they will if the vehicle will be deflected and even it can bring back to the So the requirements, like if at all embankment is very high, based on height, one has to provide, or any slope is not given properly, then there also. And curves, essentially curves based on radius of the curve, we have to provide these barriers. Water bodies, if at all any water body is there, it is essentially to be given, even though there is no curve or anything. So water bodies, we have to ensure that barriers have to be there. Or any other safety issues, for example, any land use is there, or any other development is there, to segregate that development with respect to the main traffic, so this barrier can be implemented. Another hazard, like pedestrian guardrails. So this is also a very good measure. If you don't implement in properly, then it is going to become a hazard. Suppose you, most of the times, they will give, like, for example, to discourage the crossing. So they will introduce the very sharp items, sharp edges of materials. So this is, even though people may try to cross like this, but it is going to be very dangerous for the vehicles as well. So the barrier is becoming hazard. If at all any two-wheeler, now we are talking about the errant vehicles. If at all the vehicle loses control and fall on that, the severity is going to be very high. When there is no barrier, then the accident severity would have been very less. So we have to ensure such kind of situation. So how to manage this? So there are some measures we will follow like this. First of all, if you have found any hazard, then the thing is, removing the hazard is one option, then relocating is another, then modifying the hazard if at all any possibility is there, and then protecting road users from the hazard. Around that hazard we give some all protection measures, and then alerting road users, so giving some warnings and conspicuity of that hazard can be made using some kind of stickers or something. So these are the options, but this is the hierarchy. What we should follow first, first you have to try for removing the hazard altogether. That is the best option. So if at all that is not going to be possible, then relocate. So we can slightly shift the hazard. For example, some kind of things are there, maybe some site-specific kind of things. They cannot be removed altogether. We have, in that case, relocation can be tried. Even relocation is also not possible. Then we can give some alterations, some changes to the hazard. For example, in our urban areas, the metro pillars are coming exactly very close to the road. And sometimes there are basically rectangular pillars and square pillars. And even sometimes what we have seen, they are very much decorated with the tiles and there are so much sharp edges. So those kind of things should not happen. If at all sharp edges are there, we have to modify that. If at all any errand vehicle is there, hits that object, the severity should be less. So we can smoothen the edges or something. So modify the hazard can be done in that fashion. And then install impact attenuation or redirectional devices to protect the vehicle and guard the hazard. So this is what we were discussing, like around that thing we can implement the crash attenuation measure, crash cushions kind of thing, so that the impact can be reduced. Improve delineation, that's what some markers or some warning signs. Even we can lift that hazard so that the conspicuity can be increased. Users can be seeing that hazard from the distance and then take some kind of a reaction so that it will be taken care of when the hazard comes. So this is the hierarchy we have to look into, and then according to the manage, we have to manage the hazard in this fashion. So this is the just example. It may not be possible at all the locations, but how the impact attenuation measure has to be given. Majorly it is given at the diverging ramps on high speed corridors. So if at all vehicle, any errand vehicle go away from the road and then it hits, then the impact is absorbed and the severity will be reduced. So other things like roadside hazards, like cross section itself can act as a roadside hazard. Cross sections can be like what we are seeing, embankments, like cuttings and roadside drainage. So all these things also can cause roadside hazard. So this has to be taken care. We will see, this is an embankment situation, this is a cross section what we have. So this becomes roadside hazard for the vehicle, errand vehicle. We are talking about the errand vehicle. Recovery area or safety barrier is essentially required in this case. In case of cuttings, cutting section, that was the embankment section. Cutting section also we need to allow the recovery space and also emergency standing for purpose. If at all any rocks are there adjacent to the road, then we have to smoothen those rocks to avoid snagging of vehicles. Because if any two-wheelers which is directly exposed to the rocks and hit those rocks, and the severity of the accident is going to be very high. Intensity of the crash will be very high. And provide now absolute gutters, if at all any drainage is there. Instead of giving open-ended and then if at all any vehicle goes and it will never come back, that kind of thing should not be there. And drains, we can see that drainage banks flat, provide traversable culverts, head walls, provide traversable curves.
So what do you mean by traversable?
They can go on that. They can travel for small distance on that traversable. So if that is not there, then it will go and fall into that, and then it will not come back at all. Like this, the drains, nobody will think that this is so far and then it is not a hazard. The safety is very much maintained here. But as an auditor, we have to think about the situation which is going to occur. if at all any vehicle loses the control and then if at all it goes, and then how the situation is going to be, we have to think in our mind and accordingly give the measures. That's what the auditor, when we go to the field, we have to imagine the situation, what the situation is going to happen if at all any errant vehicle is there. For normal, everybody is driving perfect skill, then there is going to be no problem at all. So now, if the vehicle goes, is out of control or any errant vehicle, then it's going to hit this, and then the accident severity or intensity of that crash is going to be very high. So in that case, this has to be taken as hazard, and then we have to implement the measures in that way that even for the errant vehicle, the safety situation has to be maintained. For that, maybe we may have to give the, as we have seen, hierarchy, the modification of the hazard, or if at all not possible, we have to protect this, and then delineation is another thing. Everything has to be given so that the errant vehicle can be protected. So that's what we have to do it. So,
Here.
Yeah, that is missing. That's what. That is missing. Not there. So, that is there. Yeah. Those are the things we have to, protecting this hazard means using the crash barrier and other. So like this, the drainage structures like safety barrier or clear zone essentially required here. Clear zone is not possible, then we have to go for the safety barriers. So another one is like delineators, is another kind of a delineation what we are discussing. So delineating that hazard. So using these delineators also, we can give the warning or increase the conspicuity of that hazard. So some situation using the delineators, we can control these errant vehicles. Another roadside hazards like power poles, which are normally comes adjacent to the carriageway. Even if you go to the state highways or MDRs, these electric poles or lighting poles for the electricity transmission purpose, they will be coming very close to this thing. So we have to follow that hierarchy. We have to remove that altogether in any case. Final option is going to be protecting that pole and then increasing the this thing, delineation, those things. Otherwise, electric poles, the option is you have to remove the electric poles from the clear.
But that part is generally not easy, one is that.
It's not easy, but one has to try that. So, we have to mention in our reports when we do the audits, and then Can we do something to avoid along this electric pole in place? Yeah, that's what I mentioned already. That removing is one thing, and if at all you are unable to remove that, there is the protection around that hazard. So the five steps, as you have seen the hierarchy, that has to be followed. Lighting poles. Urban areas or even rural areas, lighting poles are usually comes, and then it may increase the severity of the crash. If at all a rigid pole is there, it will definitely increase the severity. The options are going to be slip based or impact absorbing poles. Slip based is basically when the vehicle hits, then it will detach from the base and then it will fall. So that compared to the rigid electric pole, then the impact is going to be less in this case, and then severity. Now, at the entire thing of in this lecture, what we are focusing, how to reduce the severity of the crash, that is our main goal. Even though the situation has not occurred, it may occur in the future. That's what the starting point of our auditing. So, that is slip based is one thing. And another one is impact absorbing poles. If you see this figure, the slip base will have some problem in case the vehicle hits and then there is a impact reduction, but the pole may fall. maybe oncoming vehicles are other side, that may be a hazard for the other vehicles. In that case, impact absorbing pole can be considered, which is actually have this controlled deceleration. There is a kind of a attachment. It will not actually again fall on the other vehicles. It may be slowly falling and then taking the impact and as well as considering the other vehicles option.
So this will be only used for a new project, no? One change now, no, existing project.
Existing projects also, if at all the problem is severe, we can suggest it. As a safety auditor, we have to suggest all those things. The provision, they are simply removing, though funds are there, they want to reduce the total project cost or maintenance cost, whatever it is. So, from our side, we should not think about that, and then from our side, whatever the safety is essentially required, we can give. Let them, road holding agencies or fund sanctioning authorities, do the things. This is the risk graph, how the risk is going to be very high. If at all the, any pole comes in less than 2 meters, the risk is going to be very high. We can see from this graph. Other roadside objects, like sign support. So sign, when you install sign, that is for a good purpose, and we want to ensure the safety for the road user. We want to tell that there is going to be some curve or there is going to be some hazard situation. We want to give some warning and we want to help the road user. Then what happens, the sign is going to come on the roadside and then it will be acting as hazard, and then if at all any errant vehicle go and hit that pole, that the sign support, then the severity is going to be very high. So in that case also, sign supports also should be away from the clear zone, proper delineation and protection around that thing also has to be ensured. Another one is trees. Trees has to be...
if the sign board should be kept after the clear zone, then it again be a problem that a driver moving on the road and cannot see the sign boards, what the sign board is saying.
For example, in multi-lane roads, in that case we have to use overhead signs or we have to repeat the signs in a median and shoulder. There are some provisions. I will show the figure also. What is the distance required from the traveled way up to the sign support? So it has to be maintained. IRC 67 clearly gives these values. So trees are there. Anyway, that slide I kept, I will show that slide also. Tree is also one of the hazard. It is very difficult to remove. So in that case, that's what we face this problem. We have to ensure the road safety at that particular place with some consideration. So removing is not an option. So we have to protect that one and then give the delineation around that, some crash impact attenuation measures. All those things has to be given so that if any vehicle hits, then the impact should be less. That's why people try to plant frangible trees or plants adjacent to the road. But that will not happen. Sometimes forest department comes and immediately plants these trees once the road is open. Then if it is too late, they will be planting these kind of trees. And then if at all we want to widen, then there is not going to be any space available, then the carriageway is going to up to the trunk of the tree. So that may create the problems. So there are some issues like this. Roadside hazards is going, these kind of trees are going to be cattle, if at all they are so close to the road. Other roadside objects like bridge abutments, so when we see this, we have to do that hierarchy. We have to follow that hierarchy in hazard management. Pedestrian fencing we have discussed. Traffic management devices like traffic signs or signals or all those things. These things, everything are hazards. Parked vehicles. As I was mentioning, this is the sign and the support. Where the support is coming here? close to this shoulder. And then this is a hazard. Nobody thinks that we have done a good thing, but we have not done anything for this hazard. So, if at all there is a problem, we have to protect this hazard and give the delineation and the protection for this hazard, and all those things has to be given. So, like that, the sign supports also can act as a hazard if you don't implement the measures properly. So, this is IRC 67, how the signages has to be given from the edge of the travel way. For example, for some conditions, it has been given for different conditions in the shoulders, the distances are given, so we can ensure these distances are maintained. So, the final thing is, like, we want to ensure and enhance the road safety by providing the crash barrier. And then, we think that the crash barrier is going to improve the situation. But that crash barrier design also has to be implemented properly. Otherwise, the crash barrier itself becomes hazard. That is going to be a chaotic situation. So, we have to take care of that condition. With this, I think I reached the end of the lecture. Any questions, you can ask now.